This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Architects of Fate by Orison Swett Marden. Preface. The demand for more than a dozen editions of Pushing to the Front during its first year and its universally favorable reception, both at home and abroad, have encouraged the author to publish this companion volume of somewhat similar scope and purpose. The two books were prepared simultaneously, and the story of the first, given in its preface, applies equally well to this. Inspiration to character building and worthy achievement is the keynote of the present volume. Its object, to arouse to honorable exertion youth who are drifting without aim, to awaken dormant ambitions in those who have grown discouraged in the struggle for success, to encourage and stimulate to higher resolve those who are setting out to make their own way, with perhaps neither friendship nor capital other than a determination to get on in the world. Nothing is so fascinating to a youth with high purpose, life, and energy throbbing in his young blood as stories of men and women who have brought great things to pass. Though these themes are as old as the human race, yet they are ever new and more interesting to the young than any fiction. The cry of youth is for life, more life. No didactic or dogmatic teaching, however brilliant, will capture a 20th-century boy, keyed up to the highest pitch by the pressure of an intense civilization. The romance of achievement under difficulties, of obscure beginnings and triumphant ends, the story of how great men started, their struggles, their long waitings, amid want and woe, the obstacles overcome, the final triumphs, examples which explode excuses, of men who have seized common situations and made them great, of those of average capacity who have succeeded by the use of ordinary means, by dint of indomitable will and inflexible purpose, these will most inspire the ambitious youth. The author teaches that there are bread and success for every youth under the American flag who has the grit to seize his chance and work his way to his own loaf, that the barriers are not yet erected which declare to aspiring talent, thus far and no farther, that the most forbidding circumstances cannot repress a longing for knowledge, a yearning for growth, that poverty, humble birth, loss of limbs, or even eyesight have not been able to bar the progress of men with grit, that poverty has rocked the cradle of the giants who have wrung civilization from barbarism and have led the world up from savagery to the Gladstones, the Lincolns, and the Grants. The book shows that it is the man with one unwavering aim who cuts his way through opposition and forges to the front, that in this electric age, where everything is pusher or pushed, he who would succeed must hold his ground and push hard, that what are stumbling blocks and defeats to the weak and vacillating are but stepping stones and victories to the strong and determined. The author teaches that every germ of goodness will at last struggle into bloom and fruitage, and that true success follows every right step. He has tried to touch the higher springs of the youth's aspiration, to lead him to high ideals, to teach him that there is something nobler in an occupation than merely living-getting or money-getting, that a man may make millions and be a failure still, to caution youth not to allow the maxims of a low prudence, dinned daily into his ears in this money-getting age, to repress the longings for a higher life, that the hand can never safely reach higher than does the heart. The author's aim has been largely through concrete illustrations which have pith, point, and purpose to be more suggestive than dogmatic, in a style more practical than elegant, more helpful than ornate, more pertinent than novel. The author wishes to acknowledge valuable assistance from Mr. Arthur W. Brown of W. Kingston, R.I. O.S.M. 43 Bowdoin Street, Boston, Massachusetts. December 2, 1896. End of the Preface. Chapter 1, Wanted a Man. Wanted men. Not systems fit and wise. Not faiths with rigid eyes. Not wealth in mountain piles. Not power with gracious smiles. Not even the potent pen. Wanted men. Run ye to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem, and see now, and know and seek in the broad places thereof, if ye can find a man. Jeremiah. All the world cries, Where is the man who will save us? We want a man. Don't look so far for this man. You have him at hand. This man, it is you, it is I, it is each one of us. How to constitute oneself a man? Nothing harder if one knows not how to will it, nothing easier if one wills it. Alexandre Dumas. 'Tis life, not death, for which we pant. 'Tis life, whereof our nerves are scant. More life and fuller that we want. I do not wish, in attempting to paint a man, to describe an air-fed, unimpassioned, impossible ghost. My eyes and ears are revolted by any neglect of the physical facts, the limitations of man. Emerson. But nature, with a matchless hand, sends forth her nobly born, and laughs the paltry attributes of wealth and rank to scorn. She molds with care a spirit rare, half human, half divine, and cries exulting, who can make a gentleman like mine? Eliza Cook. In 1,000 cups of life, says Emerson, only one is the right mixture. The fine adjustment of the existing elements, where the well-mixed man is born with eyes not too dull, nor too good, with fire enough and earth enough, capable of receiving impressions from all things, and not too susceptible, then no gift need be bestowed on him. He brings his fortune with him. Diogenes sought with a lantern at noontide in ancient Athens for a perfectly honest man, and sought in vain. In the marketplace he once cried aloud, "Hear me, O men!" And when a crowd collected around him, he said scornfully, "I called for men, not pygmies." The world has a standing advertisement over the door of every profession, every occupation, every calling. Wanted a man. Wanted, a man who will not lose his individuality in a crowd, a man who has the courage of his convictions, who is not afraid to say no, though all the world say yes. Wanted, a man who, though he is dominated by a mighty purpose, will not permit one great faculty to dwarf, cripple, warp, or mutilate his manhood, who will not allow the overdevelopment of one facility to stunt or paralyze his other faculties. Wanted, a man who is larger than his calling, who considers it a low estimate of his occupation to value it merely as a means of getting a living. Wanted, a man who sees self-development, education and culture, discipline and drill, character and manhood in his occupation. 1,000 pulpits vacant in a single religious denomination, 1,000 preachers standing idle in the marketplace, while 1,000 church committees scour the land for men to fill those same vacant pulpits, and scour in vain, is a sufficient indication, in one direction at least, of the largeness of the opportunities of the age, and also of the crying need of good men. Wanted, a man who is well balanced, who is not cursed with some little defect or weakness which cripples his usefulness and neutralizes his powers. Wanted, a man of courage, who is not a coward in any part of his nature. Wanted, a man who is symmetrical and not one-sided in his development, who has not sent all the energies of his being into one narrow specialty and allowed all the other branches of his life to wither and die. Wanted, a man who is broad, who does not take half views of things. Wanted, a man who mixes common sense with his theories, who does not let a college education spoil him for practical, everyday life, a man who prefers substance to show, who regards his good name as a priceless treasure. Wanted, a man who, no stunted ascetic, is full of life and fire, but whose passions are trained to heed a strong will, the servant of a tender conscience, who has learned to love all beauty, whether of nature or of art, to hate all vileness, and to respect others as himself. God calls a man to be upright and pure and generous, but he also calls him to be intelligent and skillful and strong and brave. The world wants a man who is educated all over, whose nerves are brought to their acutest sensibility, whose brain is cultured, keen, incisive, penetrating, broad, liberal, deep, whose hands are deft, whose eyes are alert, sensitive, microscopic, whose heart is tender, broad, magnanimous, true. The whole world is looking for such a man. Although there are millions out of employment, yet it is almost impossible to find just the right man in almost any department of life. Every profession and every occupation has a standing advertisement all over the world. Wanted a man. Rousseau, in his celebrated essay on education, says, "According to the order of nature, men being equal, their common vocation is the profession of humanity, and whoever is well educated to discharge the duty of a man cannot be badly prepared to fill any of those offices that have a relation to him. It matters little to me whether my pupil be designed for the army, the pulpit, or the bar. Nature has destined us to the offices of human life antecedent to our destination concerning society. To live is the profession I would teach him. When I have done with him, it is true he will be neither a soldier, a lawyer, nor a divine. Let him first be a man. Fortune may remove him from one rank to another as she pleases. He will be always found in his place." A little short doctor of divinity in a large Baptist convention stood on a step and said he thanked God he was a Baptist. The audience could not hear and called louder. "Get up higher," someone said. "I can't," he replied. "To be a Baptist is as high as one can get. But there is something higher than being a Baptist, and that is being a man." As Emerson says, Talleyrand's question is ever the main one. Not is he rich, is he committed, is he well-meaning, has he this or that faculty, is he of the movement, is he of the establishment, but is he anybody, does he stand for something? He must be good of his kind. That is all that Talleyrand, all that State Street, all that the common sense of mankind asks. When Garfield was asked as a young boy what he meant to be, he answered, "First of all, I must make myself a man. If I do not succeed in that, I can succeed in nothing." Montaigne says our work is not to train a soul by itself alone, nor a body by itself alone, but to train a man. One great need of the world today is for men and women who are good animals. To endure the strain of our concentrated civilization, the coming man and woman must have an excess of animal spirits. They must have a robustness of health. Mere absence of disease is not health. It is the overflowing fountain, not the one half full, that gives life and beauty to the valley below. Only he is healthy who exults in mere animal existence, whose very life is a luxury, who feels a bounding pulse throughout his body, who feels life in every limb, as dogs do when scouring over the field, or as boys do when gliding over fields of ice. Pope the poet was with Sir Godfrey Kneller, the artist, one day, when the latter's nephew, a Guinea slave trader, came into the room. "Nephew," said Sir Godfrey, "you have the honor of seeing the two greatest men in the world." "I don't know how great men you may be," said the Guinea man, "but I don't like your looks. I have often bought a much better man than either of you, all muscles and bones, for 10 guineas. Sydney Smith said, "I am convinced that digestion is the great secret of life, and that character, virtue, and talents and qualities are powerfully affected by beef, mutton, pie crust, and rich soups. I have often thought I could feed or starve men into virtues or vices, and affect them more powerfully with my instruments of torture than Timotheus could do formerly with his lyre. What more glorious than a magnificent manhood, animated with the bounding spirits of overflowing health? It is a sad sight to see thousands of students graduated every year from our grand institutions, whose object is to make stalwart, independent, self-supporting men, turned out into the world saplings instead of stalwart oaks, memory glands instead of brainy men, helpless instead of self-supporting, sickly instead of robust, weak instead of strong, leaning instead of erect. So many promising youths, and never a finished man." The character sympathizes with, and unconsciously takes on the nature of the body. A peevish, snarling, ailing man cannot develop the vigor and strength of character which is possible to a healthy, robust, jolly man. There is an inherent love in the human mind for wholeness, a demand that man shall come up to the highest standard, and there is an inherent protest or contempt for preventable deficiency. Nature, too, demands that man be ever at the top of his condition. The giant's strength with the imbecile's brain will not be characteristic of the coming man. Man has been a dwarf of himself, but a higher type of manhood stands at the door of this age knocking for admission. As we stand upon the seashore while the tide is coming in, One wave reaches up the beach far higher than any previous one, then recedes, and for some time none that follows comes up to its mark. But after a while the whole sea is there and beyond it. So now and then, there comes a man head and shoulders above his fellow men, showing that nature has not lost her ideal, and after a while even the average man will overtop the highest wave of manhood yet given to the world. Apelles hunted over Greece for many years, studying the fairest points of beautiful women, getting here an eye, there a forehead and there a nose, here a grace, and there a turn of beauty, for his famous portrait of a perfect woman which enchanted the world. So the coming man will be a composite, many in one. He will absorb into himself not the weakness, not the follies, but the strength and the virtues of other types of men. He will be a man raised to the highest power. He will be self-centered, equipoised, and ever master of himself. His sensibility will not be deadened or blunted by violation of nature's laws. His whole character will be impressible, and will respond to the most delicate touches of nature. What a piece of work this coming man! How noble in reason! How infinite in faculties! In form and motion, how express and admirable, in action how like an angel, in apprehension how like a god. The beauty of the world. The paragon of animals. The first requisite of all education and discipline should be man timber. Tough timber must come from well-grown sturdy trees. Such wood can be turned into a mast, can be fashioned into a piano or an exquisite carving. But it must become timber first. Time and patience develop the sapling into the tree. So through discipline, education, experience, the sapling child is developed into hardy mental, moral, physical timber. What an aid to character building would be the determination of the young man in starting out in life to consider himself his own bank, that his notes will be accepted as good or bad, and will pass current everywhere or be worthless, according to his individual reputation for honor and veracity, that if he lets a note go to protest, his bank of character will be suspected, if he lets two or three go to protest, public confidence will be seriously shaken, that if they continue to go to protest, his reputation will be lost and confidence in him ruined. If the youth should start out with the fixed determination that every statement he makes shall be the exact truth, that every promise he makes shall be redeemed to the letter, that every appointment shall be kept with the strictest faithfulness and with full regard for other men's time, if he should hold his reputation as a priceless treasure, feel that the eyes of the world are upon him, that he must not deviate a hair's breadth from the truth and right, if he should take such a stand at the outset, he would, like George Peabody, come to have almost unlimited credit and the confidence of all, and would have developed into noble man timber. What are palaces and equipages? What though a man could cover a continent with his title deeds, or an ocean with his commerce, compared with conscious rectitude, with a face that never turns pale at the accuser's voice, with a bosom that never throbs with the fear of exposure, with a heart that might be turned inside out and disclose no stain of dishonor? To have done no man a wrong, to have put your signature to no paper to which the purest angel in heaven might not have been an attesting witness, to walk and live, unseduced, within arm's length of what is not your own, with nothing between your desire and its gratification but the invisible law of rectitude, this is to be a man. He that of such a height hath built his mind, and reared the dwelling of his thought so strong, as neither fear nor hope can shake the frame of his resolved powers, nor all the wind of vanity or malice pierce to wrong his settled peace, or to disturb the same. What a fair seat hath he, from whence he may the boundless wastes and wilds of man survey. Lines found in one of the books of Beecher's library. A man is never so happy as when he is totus in se, as when he suffices to himself, and can walk without crutches or a guide. Said Jean-Paul Richter, I have made as much out of myself as could be made of the stuff, and no man should require more. Man is the only great thing in the universe. All the ages have been trying to produce a perfect model. Only one complete man has yet been evolved. The best of us are but prophecies of what is to come. What constitutes a state? Not high-raised battlement or labored mound. Thick wall or moated gate. Not cities proud with spires and turrets crowned. Not bays and broad-armed ports. Where, laughing at the storm, rich navies ride. Not starred and spangled courts. Where low-browed baseness wafts perfume to pride. No, men, high-minded men. With powers as far above dull brutes endued. In forest, brake or den. As beasts excel cold rocks and brambles rude. Men who their duties know. But know their rights and knowing dare maintain. Prevent the long-aimed blow. And crush the tyrant while they rend the chain. William Jones. God give us men. A time like this demands. Strong minds, great hearts, true faith and ready hands. Men whom the lust of office does not kill. Men whom the spoils of office cannot buy. Men who possess opinions and a will. Men who have honor, men who will not lie. Men who can stand before a demagogue. And scorn his treacherous flatteries without winking. Tall men sun-crowned who live above the fog. In public duty and in private thinking. Anon. Open thy bosom, set thy wishes wide. And let in manhood, let in happiness. Admit the boundless theater of thought. From nothing up to God, which makes a man. Young. The wisest man could ask no more of fate. Than to be simple, modest, manly, true. In speech right gentle, yet so wise, princely of mien. Yet softly mannered, modest, deferent. And tender-hearted, though of fearless blood. Edwin Arnold. Chapter 2, Dare. The Spartans did not inquire how many the enemy are, but where they are. Agis 2. What's brave, what's noble, let's do it after the high Roman fashion and make death proud to take us. Shakespeare. Better, like Hector, in the field to die. Then like a perfumed Paris, turn and fly. Longfellow. Let me die, facing the enemy. Baird. Who conquers me shall find a stubborn foe. Byron. Courage in danger is half the battle. Plautus. No great deed is done. By falterers who ask for certainty. George Eliot. Fortune befriends the bold. Dryden. Tender-handed stroke a nettle. And it stings you for your pains. Grasp it like a man of metal. And it soft as silk remains. Aaron Hill. We make way for the man who boldly pushes past us. Beauvais. Man should dare all things that he knows is right. And fear to do nothing save what is wrong. Phoebe Carey. Soft-heartedness in times like these. Shows softness in the upper story. Lowell. O friend, never strike sail to fear. Come into port grandly, or sail with God the seas. Emerson. To stand with a smile upon your face against a stake from which you cannot get away, that no doubt is heroic. But the true glory is resignation to the inevitable. To stand unchained, with perfect liberty to go away, held only by the higher claims of duty, and let the fire creep up to the heart, this is heroism. F.W. Robertson. Steady men. Every man must die where he stands, said Colin Campbell to the 93rd Highlanders at Balaclava, as an overwhelming force of Russian cavalry came sweeping down. Aye, aye, Sir Colin, we'll do that, was the cordial response from men, many of whom had to keep their word by thus obeying. Commodore Perry, we have met the enemy and they are ours. He either fears his fate too much, or his desert's too small, that dares not put it to the touch to gain or lose it all. Bring back the colors, shouted a captain at the Battle of the Alma, when an ensign maintained his ground in front, although the men were retreating. No, cried the ensign, bring up the men to the colors. To dare, and again to dare, and without end to dare, was Danton's noble defiance to the enemies of France. The commons of France have resolved to deliberate, said Mirabeau to de Brézé, who brought an order from the king for them to disperse, June 23, 1789. We have heard the intentions that have been attributed to the king, and you, sir, who cannot be recognized as his organ in the National Assembly, you who have neither place, voice, nor right to speak, you are not the person to bring to us a message of his. Go, say to those who sent you that we are here by the power of the people, and that we will not be driven hence, save by the power of the bayonet. When the assembled Senate of Rome begged Regulus not to return to Carthage to fulfill an illegal promise, he calmly replied, "Have you resolved to dishonor me? Torture and death are awaiting me, but what are these to the shame of an infamous act or the wounds of a guilty mind? Slave as I am to Carthage, I still have the spirit of a Roman. I have sworn to return. It is my duty. Let the gods take care of the rest." The courage which Cranmer had shown since the accession of Mary gave way the moment his final doom was announced. The moral cowardice, which had displayed itself in his miserable compliance with the lust and despotism of Henry, displayed itself again in 6 successive recantations by which he hoped to purchase pardon. But pardon was impossible, and Cranmer's strangely mingled nature found a power in its very weakness when he was brought into the Church of St. Mary at Oxford on the 21st of March to repeat his recantation on the way to the stake. "Now," ended his address to the hushed congregation before him, "now I come to the great thing that troubleth my conscience more than any other thing that ever I said or did in my life, and that is the setting abroad of writings contrary to the truth, which here I now renounce and refuse as things written by a hand contrary to the truth which I thought in my heart, and written for fear of death to save my life, if it might be. And forasmuch as my hand offended in writing contrary to my heart, my hand therefore shall be the first punished, for if I come to the fire it shall be the first burned. This was the hand that wrote it," he again exclaimed at the stake, "therefore it shall suffer first punishment," and holding it steadily in the flame, he never stirred nor cried till life was gone. "Oh, if I were only a man!" exclaimed Rebecca Bates, a girl of 14, as she looked from the window of a lighthouse at Scituate, Mass., during the War of 1812, and saw a British warship anchor in the harbor. "What could you do?" asked Sarah Windsor, a young visitor. "See what a lot of them the boats contain, and look at their guns," and she pointed to 5 large boats, filled with soldiers in scarlet uniforms, who were coming to burn the vessels in the harbor and destroy the town. "I don't care, I'd fight," said Rebecca. "I'd use father's old shotgun, anything. Think of uncle's new boat and the sloop. And how hard it is to sit here and see it all, and not lift a finger to help. Father and uncle are in the village, and will do all they can. How still it is in the town. There is not a man to be seen." "Oh, they are hiding till the soldiers get nearer," said Sarah. "Then we'll hear the shots and the drum." "The drum!" exclaimed Rebecca. "How can they use it?" "It is here. Father brought it home last night to mend. See, the first boat has reached the sloop. Oh, they are going to burn her. Where is that drum? I've a great mind to go down and beat it. We could hide behind the sandhills and bushes." As flames began to rise from the sloop, the ardor of the girls increased. They found the drum and an old fife, and slipping out of doors unnoticed by Mrs. Bates, soon stood behind a row of sandhills. Rub-a-dub-dub, rub-a-dub-dub, went the drum, and squeak, 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 went the fife. The Americans in the town thought that help had come from Boston, and rushed into boats to attack the redcoats. The British paused in their work of destruction, and when the fife began to play Yankee Doodle, they scrambled into their boats and rowed in haste to the warship, which weighed anchor and sailed away as fast as the wind would carry her. A woman's piercing shriek suddenly startled a party of surveyors at dinner in a forest of northern Virginia on a calm, sunny day in 1750. The cries were repeated in quick succession, and the men sprang through the undergrowth to learn their cause. "Oh, sir," exclaimed the woman as she caught sight of a youth of 18, but a man in stature and bearing, "you will surely do something for me. Make these friends release me. My boy, my poor boy, is drowning, and they will not let me go. It would be madness," She will jump into the river, said one of the men who was holding her, and the rapids would dash her to pieces in a moment. Throwing on his coat, the youth sprang to the edge of the bank.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.